Star Wars, The High Republic, Defy the Storm. Written by Tessa Gratton and Justina Ireland. Narrated by Amber Lee Connors. Star Wars, The High Republic, Trials of the Jedi. It is a time of great turmoil. A year has passed since the destruction of the Starlight Beacon station by the nefarious Markian Rwoh and his Nihil marauders. The Nihil have established an occlusion zone in the Outer Rim, stranding hundreds of worlds behind their Stormwall. Communications are blocked, and ships that enter are lost to the void or destroyed by the Nihil. The Republic is helpless against this sinister threat, and the brave and wise Jedi Knights remain fearful of Rwoh's fabled nameless creatures, which the Jedi have learned are very real and very deadly. Chapter 1. Avon Starros hated the Nihil. She hated their ridiculous clothes, their selfishness, their violence, and every other single miserable thing about them. So, standing in her bedroom within the Nihil compound on Hetzel with her mother, Gira Starros, self-proclaimed ambassador for the Nihil, and Diva Lompop, a Nihil who had been assigned as Avon's bodyguard after many, many violent encounters, was not the place she wanted to be. Only slightly worse would be the dinner that Gira seemed determined to force Avon to attend. "It's not safe," Avon said, crossing her arms and sighing. "Even with Diva, it's just not safe, Mother. At the brunch for the visiting Hynestian Queen, someone tried to poison me. At the banquet honoring General Vis, Diva had to break a woman's neck to keep her from stabbing me. And just last week, when I was doing nothing but hanging out in my room, someone fired a blaster at my door." Gira moved through the room, picking up and rearranging the data pad and crystal samples on Avon's desk and workstation, clearly only half listening to what her daughter was saying. That was nothing new for Avon. Her mother had always been more concerned about her career than listening to Avon's problems. But this was the first time that Avon's mother hadn't been worried about her safety. Instead, the only thing she cared about was the fancy dinner they were supposed to attend. Gira Starros wore an elaborate dress of green satisteel, the collar arching up high. It looked like a pretty extravagance, but Avon had overheard her mother telling the droid responsible for creating the monstrosity to make sure no one could shoot her in the back as she sat down to dinner. Perhaps that was why Avon's mother no longer seemed so outwardly concerned about safety. Danger was part of being a Nihil. Even Nihil fashion was beholden to keeping the wearer safe or giving them an advantage in a fight. Avon knew this because she wore her own weaponry hidden under her jacket. Not that it had helped her in the past. She lacked the murderous instinct that drove all the Nihil, even her mother, apparently. "Each time you survive one of these attempts, you show them you're stronger than you look. And that is a very good thing, my heart. We are important to Markian, and that makes others jealous of us. So they try to hurt us, and when they do, we repay our debts threefold. You should welcome these attacks as a challenge. You've never shied away from something difficult before." "Crystals aren't exactly out in the galaxy pillaging and killing innocent people." Avon couldn't even look at her mother when she got like this. Once, Gira had talked of protocol and decorum, and how one should conduct oneself in the most vaunted halls of politics within the galaxy. Now she spoke of murder attempts as opportunities. Gira Starros had clearly lost every bit of her common sense, and Avon didn't know why she should pretend otherwise. "Avon, if you do not attend this dinner, Markian will be very disappointed," Gira said, turning back to give Avon a small smile. "And I do not want to disappoint Markian." Avon swallowed a scream. It would be nice to react to such an irrational statement with something just as ridiculous, but her mother wouldn't get it. Avon had met the Eye of the Nihil twice. Once at a dinner shortly after she'd arrived on his ship, the Gaze Electric, in the aftermath of the destruction of Starlight Beacon, and again at a sort of victory ceremony after the Stormwall, the passive relay net that kept all those without a path drive from safely using hyperspace, was established. It was probably better classified as a riot, as Nihil tore through the capital city wreaking havoc in the name of celebration. Markion Rwoh was a cold man, vacant and cruel, and Avon honestly couldn't see what the big deal was about him. He reminded her of the flower serpents on Haleep, pretty and deadly, without a care about anything but himself. So it was highly unlikely he gave a flying bantha turd about Avon being anywhere but in his way. Not to mention that both times Avon had met Markion, some random Nihil had tried to kill her less than 24 hours later. She could do without the drama. "Lady Starros, you'll be late if you don't head over to the event," D.Va said, her voice low. Gira sighed heavily and turned back to her daughter. "I don't have time to fight with you. D.Va, get her dressed." D.Va tilted her head, the rainbow crest of her feathers giving the movement an air of curiosity. "You want me to turn violence toward your child?" D.Va's voice held a tone of warning that caused annoyance to flicker across Gira's face. "No, of course not. Just escort her to the main hall. Avon, if you are not sitting next to me in the next hour, you can forget about going to university on Coruscant." Avon's heart fell, and a chill ran across her skin. She'd spent months negotiating and cajoling to get the chance to attend school outside of the occlusion zone controlled by the Nihil, and here was all her hard work laid to waste. "But you promised! I've already been accepted in everything! Mother, I can't stay here. It isn't safe, and it isn't... good." Avon's words failed her, and she was horrified to feel tears spring to her eyes. "Please, don't make me go to this dinner. Just let me leave Hetzel." Gira's expression softened, and she reached a hand toward Avon. But it hung in the air before curling into a fist. "People need to know I can keep my household safe, so you will not hide here. You will attend the celebration. D.Va, I leave you to it." Without waiting for a response, Gira sailed out of the room, and Avon was left alone with her minder. "Well, pup, it looks like negotiations have broken down," D.Va said with a sigh. "She doesn't care that I could die," Avon said, feeling numb. "That's the truth of it, you know. I could die, and she just doesn't care. As long as she looks strong."
"First of all, I would never let that happen," D.Va began,
and Avon waved away her words. "I know that. Honestly, you're the only person here I trust." Avon looked once more at the dress on the bed, a blue-hued twin to the one her mother was wearing. "It's just so unnecessary. I don't even know what we're celebrating."
"Triumph over the Jedi and the Republic during the Battle of Sasuena," D.Va said with a shrug. "Make sure you wear your dart gun. It's going to be a scene, I'm afraid."
"Maybe I should just stay here," Avon said, her stomach souring at her lack of options. She'd always been able to think her way out of any kind of jam, relying on her wits the way her mother had always relied on her charm. But now Avon felt lost, hopeless. How could she think her way out of this terrible cage?
"You have to get to Coruscant," D.Va said, picking up the dress and all but throwing it at Avon. She caught it, but barely. "And not just because of the university," D.Va continued. "It's about your friend. I have news."
"Imri?" Avon asked, feeling a measure of calm as she turned her thoughts to something else. She always felt better when she wasn't thinking about her mother.
"Yes. I just heard that Kara Zoo is setting up operations on Erico. There's a valuable herb there, and her profits have everyone buzzing. It's only going to be a matter of time until General Vis turns her attention there. She tends to follow the money." And where the general goes, her monsters follow, Avon said, feeling frustrated all over again. We have to get Emery away from Eriko, then. We don't have any choice.
And what about Makampa? Diva asked, her voice even as she raised a single eyebrow.
Avon groaned. For the past couple of months, ever since Avon overheard her mother talking about Dr. Makampa working on the lightning crash, the space station responsible for powering and encoding the Stormwall, Avon had been trying to figure out a way to get onto the station. It had been nothing but dead ends. Avon shook her head. Let me get through tonight, and I'll figure something out. Diva grinned, her expression affectionate.
I know you will.
Avon got dressed, leaving her boots and trousers on under the dress, since the massive skirt hid her legs. At least when things went sideways, she'd be able to run. Diva walked behind her, wearing her mask and looking every bit a Nihil while Avon tried not to look like she was afraid, even though she was terrified. What Gira Starros didn't seem to understand was that each time someone came for Avon, she felt more and more.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.